हाय हेलो फ्रेंड्स, वेलकम टू वर्ल्ड एक्सप्लोरर इंडिया। जून 14 इज सेलिब्रेटेड एज वर्ल्ड ब्लड डोनर डे। दिस ईयर थीम इज गिव ब्लड एंड कीप द वर्ल्ड बीटिंग। सो ऑन द ओकेजन ऑफ वर्ल्ड ब्लड डोनर डे, दिस इज द वीडियो इन विच आई एम गोइंग टू गिव सम ऑफ द फैक्ट्स विच आर रिलेटेड टू द ब्लड ट्रांसफ्यूजन एंड वॉट एवरी हेल्थ केयर प्रोफेशनल शुड नो अबाउट ब्लड ट्रांसफ्यूजन। William Harvey described the blood circulation, and Karl Landsteiner is the one who identified and described about the blood groups. World Blood Donor Day is celebrated every year on June 14th. This year theme is Give the Blood and Keep the World Beating. It is the blood which is very essential for human life, and it will save and improve the lives of others. Usually, blood donation is voluntary and non-remunerated, and it enhances the community solidarity and social cohesion. Blood is stored in the refrigerator at 1 to 4 degrees centigrade. There are different types of blood donors. They are voluntary or unpaid. Second is family members or replacement, and third one is paid. Every blood which is donated will undergo the screening of HIV, hepatitis B, HCV and syphilis to avoid the transmission of these diseases. For every blood transfusion, it is mandatory to have blood grouping and cross matching. The difference between blood grouping and cross matching is blood grouping decides the blood group of the patient, and cross matching is whether the blood which is being given is compatible with recipient or not. That means a blood donated by a donor should be compatible with the recipient. So that procedure is called as cross matching, usually done in the blood bank. And next is Rh typing for D antigen, that is positive and negative. So D antigen is the one which is deciding the blood group as positive and negative. Usually, in every blood donation, it is approximately 450 ml of blood is being donated. Approximately 10% of the volume, assuming that 5 liters of blood in a adult human body. Usually, the blood donated will be replaced by the body within 36 hours. Any person in the age group of 16 to 65 years of age can donate the blood at least twice in a year, but not more than thrice in a year. The minimum gap for blood donation should be 12 to 16 weeks. That is minimum of 3 months to 4 months. There should be a gap in between each blood donation. And in a year, it should not be more than 3 donations. And every blood donation will be approximately 450 ml. The minimum weight of the blood donor should be 50 kgs. And he should be free from HIV, HBV, HCV, syphilis or sexually transmitted diseases, and the good health of a person, including the stable vital signs, and there is no major diseases which are being treated for the donor. And the acceptable hemoglobin range is 13.5 for male, and for female it is 12.5 for the blood donation. Who should not give? A person who is unwell, or a person who is pregnant, a person who is on breastfeeding, and if they are on taking some treatment like antibiotics for the diseases underlying, or if they are having an HIV, STD, measles, mumps, chickenpox, cancer, etc. These are all the persons they should not go for blood donation. If a person is having more than one sexual partner, that person is at high risk of HIV, so that person also should not donate the blood. And if any person has received the blood transfusion in the last 6 months, this person also is not suitable candidate for the blood donation. And if there is a recent tattoo, drug abuse history, recent vaccination history, and URTI, diarrhea, swollen lymph glands, persistent cough, unexplained weight loss, all these persons should not donate the blood. Blood transfusion is very safe process. even though it is safe process, there are some of the risks which are involved, which I am going to discuss in this session. Usually the blood groups are having phenotype and genotype according to genetics. Let's see phenotype. Phenotype is the expression, physical expression, that is A, B, AB and O. These are the blood groups which we usually see: A blood group, B blood group, AB blood group and O blood group. The genotype is, it is the genes which are received from the both the parents. So one is called maternal allele and another is paternal allele. So this combination is going to give a phenotype later, that is A blood group. Let's see, if it is A blood group, they are having the alleles as AA or AO. If it is B blood group, it is BB or BO, and AB blood group, it is AB, and O blood group, it is OO. Now here you can see both the antigens are present in the AB blood group and there is no antigen present in the O blood group. In the same manner, antibodies are absent in the AB blood group while antibodies both are present in the O blood group. And for A blood group, anti-B is present and with the A antigen. For B blood group, it is B antigen and antibody A. So again, if PRBC can be given to the other persons but not the whole blood, so this criteria we say that every time O is the universal blood donor. O is the universal blood donor, that means his PRBC can be given to any other person, but it is not the whole blood. And we also see that AB is the universal recipient, that means this person can receive the blood from any other blood group. Again, there is one criteria, that is RH factor. This is the one which is deciding the blood group as positive or negative. So if again RH factor is decided by the D antigen, that means this is absent in O negative, that means there is no RH factor in the O negative. So universal blood donor is O negative and universal blood recipient is AB positive. Next is plasma. Plasma should be usually given of the same blood group, that means AB can give to AB, AB and O, and AB, AB can give to O. Donor recipient compatibility is converse of PRBC. This is exactly opposite of what we have discussed in the previous slide. Here O can receive from anyone but can donate only to the O group. Plasma should be free from anti-D. Again, blood groups is again decided to paternity testing. That means we already have seen that in genotype there are two alleles, that is A, B or A, O. So if there is A blood group, that means it will be A, A or A, O, or if it is O blood group, it is O, O. Now again you can see, even though there is B, O, the blood group is B because B is the dominant allele and O is the recessive allele. So again, how this paternity testing can be done is, if both the parents are belonging to O blood group, they cannot give birth to A, B and AB. If both the parents belonging to AB, they cannot give birth to O blood group. Blood group B and O, they cannot give birth to A blood group. Blood group A and O cannot give birth to B blood group. So these are the well established facts by which paternity testing can be done. Next is hemolytic disorder of newborn. If mother is O blood group but the fetus is A or B, what happens after the first delivery? There is a chance of mixing of the fetus blood with the mother, so that mother will develop the antibodies against the blood group of A or B. So if in the second pregnancy, if the fetus is having the blood group of again A or B, the fetus is going to get affected because of the antibodies which is already present in the mother. So because of which the second baby is going to develop the hemolysis. So this disorder is called as hemolytic disorder of newborn. Nurses' role during blood transfusion is they complete the request form, take the blood sample, pre-transfusion testing, blood collection, administering the blood and components, monitoring during the transfusion, and following aseptic procedure to minimize the infections. Every patient should know what are their rights related to the blood transfusion, so they should be able to give valid consent. They should be able to identify the risk, benefit, and alternatives to blood transfusion. And again, they should cross-check the patient information, the consent, blood group, and expiry dates, issue date, etc. Understand the need for transfusion. Any blood transfusion should be cross-checked by the two healthcare professionals to avoid the wrong transfusion to the patient. This is a concern of patient safety. If patient is going to develop any reaction, that is called as anaphylaxis, which is manifested by fever, flushing, pain, shortness of breath during the blood transfusion. So if any such of the anaphylactic reaction is being observed, immediately stop the blood, inform the DOD, and prescribed medication should be given on the spot. So it is very essential to mention start time and finish time, and also pre and post blood transfusion vitals. PRBC is packed red blood cells. These are preferred over the whole blood to avoid the circulatory overload in the patient. Usually stored at 2 to 8 degrees centigrade and administered over 4 to 6 hours by the use of filter. And why we are using the filter is to decrease the leukocyte count. And again, if there is reaction, stop and immediately notify the duty doctor and administer hydrocortisone, dexamethasone or avil as prescribed by the DOD. Keep oxygen, adrenaline and crash cart ready. Next is platelet transfusion. Platelet usually being given to the person who is having thrombocytopenia. For example, ITP, idiopathic thrombocytopenic purpura. So in such patients, if they are having low platelets, they are at risk of bleeding. So if there is an active bleeding, they may need the platelet transfusion. If they are undergoing surgery also, they may need some of the platelet transfusion. Usually stored at 21 to 25 degrees Celsius. Administered within an hour, usually 4 units will be transfused. Again, this also should be double verified by the two healthcare professionals. While blood transfusion, you should not give any other medication except the normal saline. The normal saline is the only one which is compatible with the blood transfusion. After blood reaction, you should emergency management of the patient, inform the blood bank with the reaction form and return the blood to the blood bank and report as per the hospital policy. And watch for delayed blood transfusion reactions such as hematuria. The patient may be very normal, but after 24 to 48 hours, patient is getting the reaction. Such type of reactions are called as delayed blood transfusion reaction. One of such reaction is hematuria. Every blood bag is having a preservative in it, that is CPD, citrate, phosphate, dextrose, which is very essential because the blood which is being collected also require the nutrients. This CPD is going to give the nutrients to the RBC, and also it will increase the viscosity of the blood, and because of which we can store the PRBC up to 28 days. Some of the patients are having the blood groups which are very rare. So that type of patients, they can go for autologous blood transfusion. That means they are going to donate their blood, and whenever they need during surgery or after surgery, they can get their own blood transfusion. Next is transfusion reactions. Every blood is having some of the risks. So such type of risks are include hemolytic reactions, allergic reactions, post-transfusion purpura, circulatory overload, and there is a possibility of bacterial contamination, trolley and taco, which this video you can see in my YouTube channel, fluid overload and pulmonary edema, delayed transfusion reactions like post-transfusion hepatitis. Next is transfusion-associated graft versus host disease. Here, any transfusion which is being given to the patient, here the patient will think that the blood which is entering into the patient is of other persons. So there will be fight between the immune systems. So because of which again the patient is developing some of the symptoms such as fever, skin rash, diarrhea, hepatorenal failure and pancytopenia. So these are the characteristic symptoms of transfusion associated graft versus host disease. Next is, with the massive blood transfusion, there is a chance of iron overload because body cannot excrete the iron which is being accumulated because of the blood transfusions into the body. So if there is excessive iron accumulation in the body, it will damage the tissue. So to avoid the iron overload in the body, there should be treatment with the chelation agents like desferoxamine. Hypocalcemia and hypomagnesemia is very common with the blood transfusions because the CPD, which is the anticoagulant in the blood bag, it will bind to the calcium and magnesium. So if the patient is manifesting the symptoms of hypocalcemia and hypomagnesemia, they may need the replacement of the calcium and magnesium. This is usually very common with the massive blood transfusions. Hyperkalemia is also common because of the destruction of the blood cells. There is a chance of HIV after blood transfusion. Even though it is very rare, nowadays because of the stringent donor selection process and again the nucleic acid test, leukodepletion techniques, using of the filter and decreased chance to get infected by the donor window period. What is window period is, the patient is looking normal, even the blood test is normal, but he is carrying the HIV, which is not manifested at the time of blood transfusion. But there is a chance or risk of the recipient to develop HIV after blood transfusion. This is very rare. It is approximately 1 in 3 million blood transfusions. But still there is a risk of HIV because of the window period. Jehovah's Witness, this is one of the Christ community where they feel that blood is sin. They will avoid the blood. So they are carrying the ID cards. If you are identifying the Jehovah Witness, so it is like advance directive. They are against the blood transfusion, so you should respect the patient culture. So this type of persons will not be going to get administered the blood until unless they are going to give the consent. The medicines which may be required after blood transfusion include Lasix or furosemide to avoid the fluid overload, and oxygen therapy may be needed. The needle used is 22 gauge or larger needle. Hematocrit changes after blood transfusion, it will increase by 3 to 5% with 1 unit. If you like this video, subscribe, like, share and comment. Thank you.